that we'll be able to pick up some narration on it. As you know, he has an awful lot of standards. You can spend nearly an hour on this, and I bet you know what? It would take, what, I think it adds up down here, yeah, 5.5 hours before you start writing the sermon.
Wow.
Now, that's fees, Gordon fees. And on the one hand, that sounds like a lot. It's not a lot of study. 5 hours to make sure you got the message right before you start deciding what to say. Especially if we're talking like a series or something. And the numbers are not meant to be absolute. Just realize that there's more to preparing a sermon than coming up with a quick outline and a poem. All right, we went over all of this. I do want to emphasize it's very important to look at the larger context. If you're preaching from Romans, now Romans is going to be a tough book to read all the way through. If you can plan ahead, do that. But if it's Philippians, I don't care if you're just doing 3 verses. Read the whole book of Philippians again. Maybe jump back in Acts and see what happened in Philippi. Several times, several verses, we've been over that. Now, along the way, depending on your style of study and lesson preparation, it probably is a good idea to write down without judgment, to brainstorm a list of things that, you know, this is about taking care of the poor, but this is also about church administration, where they messed up on it. Well, it's also about the Grecian widows and the Hebraic and Paul. Just write them all down to come back to later. Then, the content, I'm going to get to some specifics on that in a minute. Context, again, who was it sent to? Was it because there was a problem? Was it for encouragement? Was it an occasional letter like Philemon? Who's it sent to? And of course, if you're in the Gospels, and it would apply partly in Acts also, what's going on at this point? Although I think some sections of some of the Gospels are arranged topically rather than chronologically. If it's arranged topically, why? What was the point of arranging it that way? That's something we'll keep working at as long as we study. Now, good commentaries. I mentioned to Gare yesterday when we were talking about the class. He said he had used that best commentaries, I think it's .com, to pick out a book that he's using. He's going through the Gospel of John, preaching in some small church in L.A. City. And what you do is just decide that somebody's organized and listed current books, including most of the commentaries. And he asked everybody who's interested, do you think this is for a technical language study? Do you think this is for scholarly work? Do you think this is devotional oriented? Do you think this is for sermons? And you get their opinions, and does it seem to be really going by the Bible? So be selective in what you get. I think you probably are all past this stage, but young Bible majors tend to just find out that there's a bunch of free stuff on the internet that's been out of copyright since Thomas Jefferson, and they'll pull up Matthew Henry's commentaries and things like that. You might get something out of that, but it's going to be tedious. If you want to relate it, there's something more current than that. Now, there are going to be other sources, but it just depends. If you're talking about the role of women in church, you better do a little bit of research into what's going on today. But, if you have time, also research on what is the historical situation. All right, then it's talking about how does it fit in with the rest of the Bible. That's a challenge to me still. But you do need to think about it. It's all too easy to pull out a passage and think, that relates to the point I wanted to make. Let's be the other way around. Oh, that's what it says. I guess you think this point. So what's it doing in your Bible, and maybe what's it doing in this part of my Bible? And then, what important doctrines? If you were doing the part of the prison epistles that talks about family structure and employers and slaves and all that stuff. Well, you need to say, well, what is the doctrine? There might be the doctrine that work is a gift from God, it's not a punishment. You know, the very relationship of God and His people. It might be that family structure involves some submission to authority, and the fact that God calls Himself our parent, our father, there's a deep doctrine there that the family teaches the children what God is like, or should. So there are deeper doctrines. Then, I think this is a question we need to go back to. You can adapt it to another purpose, but you need to be looking to see, is this a correction? Sometimes Peter and Paul can be extremely harsh on false teaching. But to apply that to someone who was mistaken on what a figure in the book of Revelation means and call him a false teacher, like the ones that are preying on people and making them immoral, that's not the same thing. Be careful that you look at its purpose and use it appropriately. Are they calling for a certain action, like when Paul's trying to get the money out to the poor? Is it telling them what to believe or to increase their faith and to trust? And then, who is it written to? Although I wish it was different, you're mostly going to be talking to believers. So if this, like Paul's speech to the Areopagus, they weren't believers. Well, that applies, that certainly means something to the context. You have to kind of turn the point over to apply it to this group. Is it about society in general? Is it only about the church? Is it only about this church, this congregation? So when you're working on your exegesis, I want you to answer as many of these types of questions as you can based on your study of that scripture. All right, now this is the high-powered stuff. The limits of the passage. You've really got to work on number two. And that's hopefully this weekend I can start looking at some of your notes. I can make some suggestions along that way. It is a mistake to take John 3:16 without 17 and 18. You know what I mean? You can't appreciate that He came to save the world if you can't understand that the world is condemned. And you probably then need to go out and say, well, who's He talking to? Oh, looks like He's talking to Nicodemus. And then if you really want to study, say, or is that John's commentary on what Jesus did? Because it kind of changes from he to I to he. You see how all that? Not stuff you're necessarily going to put in your sermon. The Gospel of John has a lot of times where it's an aside from the apostle writing it, explaining something. And the four could very well be, for God so loved the world, could be explaining what He had just said to Nicodemus. So you need to work out in your head how you believe that went, so that you can present what He's saying to Nicodemus has to do with a God searcher with a strong Jewish background, who was open to the reality that Jesus might be the one, but He did come to him by night. He later stood up for him. Or is that God so loved the world as broad as we've tried to apply it? If it does jump to the world instead of, you know, how the Spirit is in a certain person. So, structures and syntax. I need to study up more on syntax. But we mean how the sentences are constructed, whether this is a random thought here and there, or this is a long argument. Yeah, how he structures it. For S-Y-N-T-A-X. For instance, the early chapters of Romans. If you're not aware that there's an extended metaphor of a courtroom here, and here's why the Jews are condemned, and here's why the Gentiles are condemned, he just kind of goes off in a lot of different ways. Yeah. If you can't relate it back to the central concept, then you may be applying a meaning that was not really what it was there for. But the syntax, you get that from actually how it's written.
So the syntax would be that he's trying to show the Jews that you're just as guilty as you said these other folks were?
The question is there anything about the way the sentences flow And there might be an interjection or there might not be. Is it focused on one? So, or is this a broad? And what I'm saying is, for example, there, it's a very long, extended lesson.
Yeah.
And you can get all the sins, all the short of the glory of God, but really it's in a much broader context. It's a lesson in itself. But if you know the context, even if you don't point out everything in that lesson, if it's a classroom, you will be, if somebody has a question, you can expand it. Or if it's in a one-way lesson, you have to decide whether it matters or not. This, confirming the limits of the passage and establishing the text, go together. And I'll show you a little bit more about establishing the text in a few minutes. I don't think it would be appropriate to take the story of the woman caught in adultery and try to connect it closely to the passages immediately preceding and following. Now, it could be done and it would take some serious study. But the fact is, the most ancient manuscripts do not place that passage at that point in John. There's almost no question. John didn't put it there. Sounds like John. It's been preserved as long as the Gospel of John. But to try to figure the structure of that section of John around that beginning of chapter 8 would have been a mistake. And you have to establish the text. So you can't really say when that happened in the life of Jesus. Similarly, that one is broken up so funny. The first part of the out of place text is like the last half of the last verse of the preceding chapter. And so, regardless of how your printer did the punctuation and the titles and all, you have to do the best you can to get behind that and say, you know, that really slants it this way. I really think this goes with the previous section. And you've got to see what here is really connected to this part. And that needs to be at least the text that you read at the beginning of class, or tell people ahead of time, read this before you come, so that you've got the whole thought. Even if you're only going to focus on part of it, you need to know, what is this section? Some are very long, some are quite short. Usually, I think they're going to be somewhere around a dozen verses. Just a second. You understand what I'm saying? If you had to do the paragraphing, how would you do it? And remember, hadn't I talked about this before? The original text, did you get one of Dr. Parker's classes where you had to look at the Sinaiticus? You know what I'm lying about. And it's all capital letters. There are no spaces. There's no punctuation. There's no hyphen because the left half the words on the next line. So every punctuation mark, every capital spirit or lowercase spirit is an interpretation. And even though for a long time people have thought, this is a unit, this is a unit, and there's reason to think, well, if they thought it that long, maybe it is a unit. But a lot of times I think, no, that really goes with the next section. Not that you need to make a big deal about that in your presentation. You just don't include it if you don't think it relates. Or someone says, well, but you left out that verse, and you think, well, I really think that goes with what Paul was saying before. Not that it's unrelated, but it's not. The grammar, if you don't have much background in the original languages, you're going to have to trust some good scholarly writers. One thing that I've learned a lot from Dr. Parker is, and I sense that even from my preaching these days, people will say, well, what does the Greek say on this? And usually it's exactly the same thing the English says. It's rare that you can settle something because the Greek means it this way. Don't you agree? I mean, you will get much more about verb tenses and stuff like that, but you know, just because the word was anthropos doesn't settle it. But which ones are significant? But whether it's present tense or past tense, unfortunately, sometimes they're spelled the same way, and sometimes it makes a difference in your understanding. And a big one is of. The faith of Christ, the righteousness of Christ. Does that mean be as good as Jesus? It could. Does that mean understand that you're only righteous because of Christ? And you should eventually get to, let's see, Trent was going to do the love of money. I did a little bit of study on money and which love that is. Historical, cultural background, use a good Bible, a good study Bible. It'll have an introduction to every book. I like a lot what's in the ESV study Bible. And the version I bought, you can also see it online, so it's have it in print, which is good because the print is tiny and the pages are onion paper. They'll give you a lot of that. The formal character of the passage. Is this a formal letter? Is it a personal letter? Is this a scolding? Is this an encouragement? And of course, you know, is this a story or is this a letter? And nothing in the New Testament, nothing more important than, oh, Revelation is an island to itself, as far as the formal character of it. Except for those letters to seven churches. And they're kind of weird, too. The literary context, not that it is only a work of literature, but as a work of literature, what is common about human expression in writing here? Where does it fit? You could tell if I say, I'm so hungry I could eat a horse, it's probably totally unrelated to anything I said. But because that's an idiom, the way we say it, you want to look and see, well, in what context did he say that? Was he starving and was there a horse there? You look at the story, you see that. And then the talked about before. All right. See these good questions here? I will not get to all of this today, but I am going to put it up on the Bible for you. All right. Who was this written to? In the first century?
Especially on blackboard.
In the first century, it was especially in the first of the first century, it was real important whether they were Jewish or Gentile. They were Jewish and Gentile culturally Jews, and they didn't get along with each other. The Samaritan woman, the story of the Good Samaritan.
Yeah.
All right. Is this someone that he loves and is encouraging? Is this a church that he's wept over and has been misunderstood? I never will forget. I didn't know he was famous, but and I've forgotten his name. Oh, Abraham Malherbe. Did some works on the Thessalonian epistle. He happened to be the speaker when I was working with some of the different churches on the campaign. This is outside of Boston, permanent life. And he was at Harvard, Yale, I don't know. He was the guest speaker. Later, when I read things he had written, you remember the Thessalonians had people who wouldn't work and were gossips and all those things? He points out that Thessalonica, which is still pronounced differently, but it's still Thessalonica, the big city. You can't see many of the ancient ruins because there's a city on top of it. Well, it turns out we have pretty good reason to believe that working people probably lived in the apartment house, the first floor of which was the shop. Now, can you see how much more difference it makes now if somebody quit work? And they didn't hire anybody else. You got to do that for them. But he lives next door to you in the apartment. It worked out beautifully for us. But when I worked in housing here, there was us in this building across the parking lot. There was Gwen Chapman and across the street. And at Stout, when I first took the job, the meals were part of the pay. We ate together. We worked together. We fell asleep across the parking lot from each other. We had the same weird schedule. On top of that, we all sat on the same pew in church. Now, if we had had a falling out, that would have been a bigger deal than if there's somebody I barely know goes to the same church. Or if one of us was leaving all the work for the other one to do, saying, oh, I have to go to my granddaughter's and I'll be gone for 2 weeks. Can you cover my building? Can you see how that... And then you add to that in the Thessalonian epistle, well, Jesus is coming. I don't think I'll work anymore.
Yeah.
And you live next to them, and you work with them, and your job has been affected, and they're kind of connecting it to the religion you share.
Yeah.
You see how knowing that they would have lived in apartments over the shop? Oh, I can see how that'd be a big deal for the Thessalonians. All right. There's not always an explicit purpose, but if there is, you better connect with it. Can you tell, Hebrews has its own language. You have to be deeply rooted in the Old Testament to understand it. You know, the fact that believe appears on every other line of the Gospel of John means that's an important thing in the book of the Gospel of John. You add to that, he says, I wrote these things so that you would believe. All right. If you were to do this, make an annotated outline of the whole book, I would say avoid seeing somebody else's outline first. And don't make more than 6 or 8 points. You're not trying to, you don't have time to analyze the whole book. But we'll be saying, you know, here he's being diplomatic with them, here he's scolding them, and here he's coming back to reconcile them. That kind of outline. Secondary literature, we're talking about commentaries and stuff. I want to carry you forward a little bit. All right, I don't know about sentence diagrams, but here's one that he gave as an example. Notice, but. So there's something to the sentence structure here. So you go through and you notice, we. All right, who is the we? All right, we speak. Those are the, you remember when you had found the subject and verb? Those are the subject and verb of this sentence. So you better come back and see. In both of them, it's about speaking wisdom. But. There's a contrast. The more indented ones are explaining about ones that are more to the left. There's a relationship between the concepts. All right? You're speaking wisdom, but look at the structure. There are people who, and then there's the thing, the mystery, which. You see, it's a pretty complicated sentence, but there is a structure to it. And it may not be that the Greek is structured exactly that way, but if it's a good translation, it's helping you see the relationships of one idea to another. There are a few times that that would be very helpful. Let's see. All right. There isn't a subject. This is a command, an encouragement. So it's rejoice, pray, and give thanks. And then the rest of it is explaining the previous part. This, okay, you have to know what this is up here. Is it this praying, or is it, as this indicates, this is the will of God. Doing this is God's will. And then the other ones is describing Christ. All right. Y'all will come to this next time. Would somebody tell me what the bottom section is? Means? Anybody know why it's there? I highlighted the parts you need to know. What does that mean? Or that? Furthermore, why is there a theta in the middle of these Roman letters, and then there's an olive? I don't know 3 people who could read through that and make sense of it. Does anybody know what it is? It's called the apparatus. This is from a Greek New Testament. And the apparatus tells you which ancient documents might vary in one way or another. And they have letters. I'm guessing Olive is either Alexandrinus or Sinaiticus. W is Washingtoniensis, because it's held in Washington. And so you look through all that if you're doing deep study, or see here, this one says this one has mo, or maybe the other one has you. All that, there's a reason that it's there, and there's much more to it than you realize. However, I don't even remember looking at the specifics of this. But I would say that at least 90% of the stuff here is relatively irrelevant to the point of the passage. It's there because we want to be able to tell people, in all honesty, people have looked carefully at the ancient version. We have a list of more variations than you ever want to see. And I'm going to study, and if one of them is significant, we'll discuss that. But I'm saying that's what you want to tell your class. But in general, it's just this one used to common, this one used to period. So we'll look at that. This is what I want to, I'll let you know, we may meet in the library, the computer room downstairs, because in one of the programs, I think it's Logos, they have this textual commentary on the Greek New Testament. It's not a commentary. It lists, according to Metzger, the world's expert, which are significant variations and why people think they're significant, as opposed to all that gobbledygook in the apparatus. So if I can show you that, we'll call it good. All right, see there where you can actually read this. Even if you don't know what the letters stand for, there's a place to look them up if you ever want to know. But it says, it's possible to argue that the clause accidentally fell out. But most of the shorter texts, and he tells you all what they are, it should be noted that when the clause is present, there are 15 generations, you know, this is the genealogy. And you look at, well, why would there be different lists? Well, as it says, you know, there are this many and this many and this many. And so there are reasons to look at why it would be different. And when you have time to do ahead of time study of the section that you're going to do a series on, then if you get your hand on something like this, it's a little bit, and of course it's digital now, and skim through which ones might make any difference and which ones might not. And if I can find it, I'll bring you also next week. There was a teacher at Ohio Valley University who made a list. I don't know if it was just a certain book, but he had a list. Here are the ones that most people think matter. And if you have those tools for when you study, you can do a lot of deeper study. So, did I say I want some kind of filled out as much as you can? And this time, even almost in just filling out the form. I think this issue relates to this passage, this and this one. If you say I don't think it relates, have a reason. If you just didn't get to it, you'd be just fine. I'd love to have it. It just doesn't matter. But if you thought through it and say, there's really not an issue here, say something. Then I looked at it, and love means love, and hate means hate. There's no special thing in here. And the idea is that you're going to get a feel for where you're going with it. And then you have the next month to do an official exegesis that I will have Dr. Parker, Dr. Stark, and Dr. Bailey. Unless you give me money. And then I'll get it. You're a college student, aren't you? And you live in that neighborhood. Oh, no. I appreciate it. I appreciate your enthusiasm. I appreciate when you're picking up on what relates to you. And we want to make ourselves good students of the Bible, which is this month. Next month, we got to jump into doctrine. Now, I want you to stop and think, and I'm going to ask a lot of my colleagues if I can. How do we use the word doctrine? Like, on the old Greek lands, you had to take some of these doctrinal courses. Well, if you don't need to tell you, you know doctrine just means teaching. Wow. What's in the Bible that is a doctrine? You know? So we need to look at that. But then I found out when I was wandering from the preacher's point in his sermon on Sunday, as I was skimming through, sometimes I do skim in a Greek testament, the doxalia doctrine happened to show up in the passage you said, so where that should be. significantly, and sometimes the gospel, the gospel is the gospel, shows up more in 1st and 2nd Timothy than in the rest of the New Testament. So let's be content with that. On the other hand, I didn't have time to look up their preferred form and their other forms. But then it might be significant that that particular form is just almost only here. So maybe you can do that as you're studying through the Timothy Titus for your lesson. Notice how often or if recently in relative in relation to your passage, he's mentioned doctrine. It may not be translated that way, but teaching the doctrine. And if so, maybe I can help myself and then my listeners understand what doctrine means in the New Testament. So anyway, you don't have to pay for a doctrine now. But I can figure out which doctrine you're eligible for. That's enough for today. Sorry I kept you a little bit long.
Can you take a moment?